हेलो एवरीवन, माय सेल्फ डॉक्टर घनश्याम चौहान, फोकसिंग ऑन द टॉपिक लिम्फेटिक फिलेरियासिस इन द सेशन ऑफ सोशल एंड प्रिवेंटिव फार्मेसी। सो फ्रेंड्स, व्हाट इज लिम्फेटिक फिलेरियासिस? एक्चुअली दिस डिसीज इज ऑकर ड्यू टू द मॉस्किटोज एंड इट कैन बी द इन्फेक्शन कैन ऑकर ड्यू टू द पैरासाइट्स एंड दैट पैरासाइट्स आर मोस्टली अफेक्टिंग ऑन योर लिम्फेटिक सिस्टम। That's why it is called as lymphatic filariasis, and the name of the parasite is filaria. So it occurs the infection filariasis, and the vector is mosquito. Through mosquito it can be spread from one person to the another person. In the introduction we must know it will affect which part of our body. It will affect mostly on the leg part. So it is also called as elephantiasis, or it will also called as the elephant leg, because our leg size will increase so much tremendously that it will enlarge in the size in uncontrollable proportion. That's why it is also called as elephant leg. Filariasis has been a major public health problem in India, next only to malaria. The disease was recorded in India as early as 6th century BC by the famous Indian physician Sushruta in the book Sushruta Samhita in 7th century AD. Madhavakara described signs and symptoms of disease in the treatise Madhava Nidhana, which has good even today. In 1709, Clark called elephantoid leg in the Cochin as a Malabar leg. The discovery of microfilariae is nothing but the it is the parasite and which is in micro in size. It is very small in size. That's why it is called as microfilariae. It can be entered into the pores of our skin when that mosquito bites you, when the mosquito prepare a hole, and through that hole it get entered into our skin, into our body. And the discovery of microfilariae in the peripheral blood was made first by Lewis in 1872 in Calcutta. Filariasis is caused by several round, coiled and thread-like parasites, worms belonging to the family Filariidae. These parasites, after getting deposited on skin, penetrate on their own or through the opening created by the mosquito bites. Mosquito bites are producing some openings, and through that opening these parasites are penetrating, they are getting inside into our body to reach the lymphatic system, and they are targeting on our lymphatic system, on our lymph nodes. And you know where the lymph nodes are available, they are mostly available on your, especially on your leg part or your arm part. So they are targeting on our lymphatic system. Based on the pathogenicity and habitat, in classified into four types: first, lymphatic filariasis; second, subcutaneous filariasis; third, serous cavity filariasis; and fourth, zoonotic filariasis. Lymphatic filariasis is commonly known as elephantiasis. That's why I have called it as a elephant-like leg. It is a neglected topical disease. Nowadays it's very rare, but in early days it have become very common. And once it occurs, it becomes a stigma to the society. The infection occurs when filarial parasites are transmitted to the human through mosquitoes. Infection is usually acquired in the childhood, causing damage to the lymphatic system. The painful and profoundly disfiguring visible manifestation of disease. This is very bad. Disfiguring your body means especially your leg is going to be disfigured. It looks very, very bad. It looks very, very dangerous, very vulgar. Lymphedema. So there is accumulation of the fluid into your lymph occurs, and pain in your lymph occurs, especially in your arms, in your hand and in your legs. Pain will occur, lots of pain will occur. That condition is called as lymphedema. Elephantiasis and scrotal swelling. Elephantiasis means your leg will become very heavy, its size, its mass becomes too much, so it is called as elephantiasis. And also scrotal swelling occurs, means at the part of your scrotum, means below your testes, the scrotal protective covering is there of the typical skin, so that scrotal swelling occurs in the later in the life and can lead into the permanent disability. It also affects on our scrotum. This, and if it affects on scrotum, it will affect on our fertility. So these patients are not only physically disabled but suffer mental, social and financial losses, because these people are not getting any jobs anywhere, they cannot move, they cannot do work properly, and also these people are not accepted in society. People are looking very badly towards them, and also mental, because they are not getting satisfaction by themselves, and it becomes stigma. It is a symbol of stigma and poverty. Because can you see this? This is lots of luggage is there, so it is nothing but the burden on yourself, on your body. So though your whole body is good, but if your leg becomes a stigma to you, it becomes a burden for you, so how can you carry that burden all over the world? So it will be very difficult to carry your unwanted part in whenever you go, wherever you go. It is endemic in the many tropical and subtropical countries like Africa, Asia, Eastern Pacific and parts of America. More than 1.4 billion people are at risk, and approximately 65% reside in WHO's South Asia region. Over 120 million people are currently infected, and about 40 million disfigured and incapacitated by the disease. 1.4 billion people live in the area with risk of infections. Out of them, 120 million are infected and need treatment. Out of them, 40 million people are with overt disease. Overt disease means which you can see by your naked eyes, means it is easily observable. You can see by your naked eyes and easily you can identify a person is having some problem, some disease. 15 million people with lymphedema, they are having pain into their legs and arms. And 25 million men with urogenital swelling, mainly scrotal hydrocele. Scrotal hydrocele occurs at two stages. Either it occurs in the beginning of your childhood, means when you are at fetus stage. So at that period, what happens to your scrotal, means it is a protective covering of your testes, it is a skin, it is the elastic skin which gives elasticity to your scrotum. So at your scrotum, the filling of fluid occurs, and due to which the lots of swelling occurs. So if you see the natural size of the testes or scrotum, it is normal, but if it swells, it doubles or triple of its size, it completely swell. So in the childhood, up to the 1 year, after 1 year the symptoms will disappear, but in case of adulthood, if it occurs, so it stays all over your body, all over your life. So in adulthood also it swells, the accumulation of fluid occurs into your scrotum, and it will affect on your sterility also, in your fertility also, so person will become sterile. Global burden. In some countries like Brazil and in Chile, like this if you'll find. In Africa, the countries like Nigeria, after Sudan, Egypt, Tanzania, Botswana, Ghana, after that, in this country, Madagascar, in this country you will find, and also in the Saudi Arabia, Yemen, in India, Pakistan, China, Bangladesh, Myanmar, after that, Indonesia, Mali, Maldives, and that Sumatra, in this South Asian country also you will find Indian scenario. The overall micro filaria rate has reduced from 1.25% in 2004 to 0.29% in 2015 at the national level. Means it has been declined from 1.2 to 0.29%. Out of 255 districts, 203 have reported overall microfilaria rate of less than 1%. Out of remaining 52 districts, 31 need a high priority, and these districts have been persistently reporting microfilaria rate above 1%. Filarial epidemicity in India. In India, you will see, it will find mostly in the Bihar, Jharkhand, Odisha, West Bengal, Chhattisgarh, some part of MP, Karnataka, Andhra, and some part of Gujarat. Heavily infected areas include UP, Bihar, Jharkhand, Andhra Pradesh, Odisha, Tamil Nadu, Kerala and Gujarat. Epidemiology. Agent factors. There are at least 8 species of filarial parasites that are specific to man. They are Wicheria bancrofti. It is a major culprit which is responsible for filariasis. Second is Brugia malawi, and third is Brugia timori. So these are the three main species which is responsible for filariasis, and also there are remaining 5 species: Onchocera volvulus, Loa loa, T. perstans, T. streptocerca, Mansonella ozardis. Out of these, first three are causes lymphatic filariasis. Periodicity. Both the microfilaria of Wicheria bancrofti and B. malai occurring in India display are nocturnal periodicity. Means they are mostly infecting, they are invading human being at night, nocturnal periodicity. They are specifically, they are invading, they are producing infection at the night period. The maximum density is reported between 10 pm to 2 pm. This is the biological adaptation to the nocturnal biting habits of the vector mosquito. Why this time? Because this is a specific time where the mosquitoes are biting at the higher rate. Before that they are having less effectivity, but between this period they are having high specificity, they are having high chances of biting. Now we'll discuss the life cycle of these filaria and mosquitoes. So definitive host man, intermediate host mosquito. The adult worm microfilaria are found in the lymphatic system of man, where they may survive for 15 years or more. Means they can survive in the body of human being more than 15 years. During their lifespan, after mating, female worms, what they are doing? They are giving birth to the more than 50,000 immature microfilaria per day. See the rate. That's why our size of lake will enlarge as fast as it can, and they will spread into the bloodstream via circulation and via lymphatics, and they may survive up to 1 year or more. Means each worm will survive up to 1 to 2 years. Some of these macrofilari may ingested by the mosquito during their blood meal. stages in the mosquito. First, egg sheathing. The larva comes out of the sheath in which it was enclosed in the stomach of mosquito. Means they will comes into the larva comes out of the sheath, means larva will come out from that external coating covering and enclose into the stomach. They will go and store into the stomach of mosquito. They will go into the stomach. Now first step of larva, the larva penetrate the stomach of mosquito, means they will penetrate, they will cut the stomach and they will come out from the stomach and migrate to the thoracic muscle. So they will go to the thoracic muscle of the mosquito, and where they develops into the short thick form, their development occurs into the thoracic muscle. And second stage of larva, the larva molds and increase in length, means larva leave their external coat, leave their external coating, and they are increasing their length. And third stage of larva, ineffective, the larva molds and develop into the long thin form. The larva come out from that larva stage, it leaves their external coating and come out from them, and they will develop into the long thin form and which migrate into the proboscis. What is proboscis? Proboscis is nothing but the what you can say, the elongated long thin nose of the mosquito, nose or biting teeth, what you can say. So whatever things you can understand, whatever the sting which they are inserting into the body of our human being, that sting is nothing but the proboscis. So they are entering into that proboscis of the mosquito. The mosquito is said to be infected. Once they are entering into the proboscis of mosquito, means the mosquito is said to be infected. Now the mosquito is ready to infect the another human being. See, this is the life pattern or lifestyle of that parasite, that Wuchereria bancrofti. So now they have been entered into the this proboscis of the mosquito. So this is proboscis of the mosquito. They had been entered here, means now they are ready to invade, to do the infection into the human being. Now they will bite. Mosquito takes a blood meal, means they are biting to the human being here. This is the stage one. Once they are biting, after that they are entering into the human being, means they are leaving that adult, that filaria, they are leaving that adult Wuchereria bancrofti, that parasite, into the human being. Now that parasite will spread into the human being, adult in lymphatic. Now they will targeted to the lymphatic system. Means from the blood, they enter into the blood. From blood, they will target the lymphatic system. After that, adult produces sheath microfilary that migrate into the lymph and blood channels. Now they are producing this sheathed microfilary, developing into the sheath microfilary. After that, the mosquito takes a blood meal. Again, mosquito will take blood from the human being. And the second part of stage, which occurs into the body of mosquito. So this happens in the body of human being. Now again from here, it will continue into the body of mosquito. So mosquito bite to the human being. And after that, the microfilary sheath, whatever the sheath has been developed here, that sheath has been penetrated into the mosquito midgut. Means they will go into the stomach through the mouth, through the proboscis, they will go into the mouth, and through the mouth they will go into the stomach, and they will go into the stomach, and from stomach they will go into the midgut and migrate to the thoracic muscle. And as you know, in thoracic muscle they will develop from larva 1, means the small size of larva. After that they will develop into larva 2 size, and here the larva is elongated, thin, rounded in shape. Now it is ready to migrate. So migrate to the head and mosquito proboscis. Now here they will directly go towards the head of the mosquito, or you can say that spout or sting of the mosquito which put it outside, and through that sting again it is ready to infect to the another human being. So in this fashion the cycle completes. So try to understand the cycle. In this fashion it is a cycle for parasite, half part in human being and half part into the mosquito. Incubation period. The extrinsic incubation period, the time interval for microfilary to develop inside the mosquito to third stage infective larva, it is for 10 to 14 days. Pre-patent period, the time interval between introduction of infective larva and the first appearance of the detectable microfilary in the peripheral blood, it is from 12 to 18 month. And clinical incubation period, the time interval from invasion of infective larva to the development of the clinical manifestations, it is 8 to 16 month. Reservoir of infection. Although filarial infections occurs in the animals, human filariasis is not usually a zoonosis, means it not directly come from the animal to the human being. In man, the source of infection is a person with circulating microfilary in the peripheral blood. In filarial disease, late obstructive stages, microfilary are not found in the blood. Vectors of lymphatic filariasis. So try to understand, as in last two lectures we have come across with the mosquitoes, it is Aegypti and another species. So that was the culprit. Here we are having two species of these mosquitoes. One is Culex and another is Mansonia. So try to understand, try to see their body, their figure, how they look, try to identify the mosquito. It is a normal mosquito which are spreading, which has revolving in our society also from here and there. Culex, vector for Bancroftian filariasis. So for the Bancroftian filariasis, it is responsible for this infection. Its name is Culex. And Mansonia vector is for Bruggian filariasis. There are two types of parasites. Bruggian filariasis, it can be spread by the mosquito, Mansonia, and Bancroftian filariasis, this parasite can be spread by the Culex mosquito. Culex breed in polluted water, means in mud water or in waste water or drainage water, where it can be spread and bred. And the Mansonia is associated with the certain aquatic plants. In aquatic plants, its growth or breeding will occur. Host factors. Man is a natural host. Age. All age are susceptible to infection. The infection rates rise with age up to 20 to 30 years and then level off. Gender. In most endemic areas, microfilary rate is higher in men. Migration. Migration led to the extension of filariasis into non-endemic areas. Immunity. It develops only after years of exposure. Social factors. Lymphatic filariasis is associated with the poor sanitation, urbanization, migration of people. These are the major three causes of these infections. Environmental factors. A. Climate. It influences the breeding of mosquitoes. If mosquito will breed more, they will increase the more infection, they will do the more spreading, more transmission. So their longevity and the development of parasites in insects vector is 22 to 38 degrees Celsius and RH is 70%. Drainage. Vectors breed profusely in polluted water. Town planning. Inadequate sewage disposal. That is a major cause. If you don't have any inadequate sewage disposal, definitely it will pour the waste water all over the ground, and due to which the spreading and the breeding of this mosquito will occur, and lack down planning and aggravated the problems of filariasis in India. The common breeding places are open ditches, means where the water can accumulate. They are the temporary sources of water pond. Water ponds are there where the water can accumulate. Specific tanks where it is not closed, they are open tanks where the mosquitoes can breed themselves. They will lay their eggs there, and the larvae will increase in their size. And ill-maintained drains, means when you are not maintaining the drainage system, not properly cleared, not properly the garbage has been collected and cleaned, so not properly cleaned, so in that condition it will spread more and more transmission of that mosquito. Here you can see, this is the example. So curious quinquennae fascicutes breeding sites, so here they can breed very fastly. This is the favorable condition for them, where they can easily grow and they will bite the children nearby area. Clinical manifestations: lymphatic filariasis, stage of invasion, asymptomatic carrier stage, stage of acute manifestations, and stage of chronic manifestations, and occult filariasis. Now clinical features: recurrent attacks, means again and again the attack will come, means as the mosquito will bite, they will increase the infections of filariasis. Filarial fever, they can also produce the fever among them. If you are having that infections, they will go enter into your bloodstream. Lymphangitis, so it affects on our lymphatic systems, they produce the inflammation. Lymphadenitis, epidermorchitis in males, means they are affecting on our epididymis, on our testes, and the inflammation of that epididymis will occur, which results into the sterility. And mastitis in females, and lymphoedema, which will develop the pain into the arms, upper arm and lower arms. And enphatiasis, means the size and mass of the leg will increase. Elephantiasis, it looks like elephant leg. Hydrocele, accumulation of that fluid into our legs area specially. And at chiluria, here acute filariasis, lymphangitis, here it is acute dermatolymphangioadenitis. It is a after acute attack of that parasites. Chronic obstructive lesions, so if it, this is, you can see this is a normal leg, and this is the elephantiasis. See the size, how bad it looks, how dangerous it is. So it is very difficult to carry that leg from one place to the another place. So this LF is social evil. This lymphatic filariasis is a social evil. So disfigurement is a major drawback. Disfigurement of limbs and genitalia leads to the stigma, means it looks very bad and it give bad impression on others. So it looks stigma, means you are ashamed of yourself. Anxiety, lots of fear is there, lots of anxiety is there for yourself. You are not going to be confident. And ostracization, self-blaming or self-shyness will develop. Psychological trauma is there. You are not having confidence among yourself. You are criticizing, self-criticism will develop among yourself. Sexual dysfunctioning, the disease impedes. So what it affects, disease. So here you can see these examples how it affects, and how it affects on the important things of our life. Mobility, you cannot move easily from one place to another place. Traveling, you cannot travel from one place to another place. You cannot go into any functions, any programs, to attend any event. educational opportunities. You cannot go for college, school, for taking educations, for attending any programs, for attending any special conference or anything. You cannot get knowledge, you cannot get any information. Employment opportunities, you are not getting employment also. How can you get employment if you are not going to be sufficient to do the work? If it require for physical mobility is required for your work and you are not able to physically mobile, so in that condition no any employer will give you any employment. Marriage prospective, because as sexual dysfunction occurs, it directly affects on your marriage chances. Now this lymphatic filariasis strains the economy. The global economy cost as US dollar up to 2 billion per annum. India losses 1.2 billion man days annuals, means how many days man will work, so it loses 1.2 billion days annually. So that much losses is there. Estimated economic loss in India alone in US is 850 million US dollar per year in India alone. The economic loss is equivalent to 0.05% of GNP. It is a gross product. So a major cause of poverty in the regions. So it is a gross net productivity. So whatever the productivity is there, it can be affected. It will be near about 0.05%. It is very less. How can this LF be diagnosed? Clinical examination for filariasis symptoms. Detection of microfilary in microfilary carriers. So thick blood film, it is 20 centimeter microscopy at night. MFC method, it is a minimum fungicidal concentration method. Is we are giving the fungicide at minimum concentration to identify the microfilary. And DEC, so diethyl carmazepine provocation test. So this diethyl carmazepine, it is an antifungal drug which is given to the person to identify whatever the concentration of microfilary in their body. So it is a test for detection, for identification. Antigen detection, it is a immunochromatographic test, field friendly, sensitive and specific, easy to perform and can be done at any time during the day and night. And DNA based molecular techniques are also available there. So this is the actual look of that parasite, how it looks. It is microfilary in peripheral blood. Filaria survey, 5-7% of population for routine survey and 20% for evaluation studies. It consists of mass blood survey, clinical survey, serological test, xenodiagnosis. What is xenodiagnosis? It is nothing but the when we are doing any test for diagnosis of any infection. So when you are going to be identify any microorganism, any pathogen for identification of that disease. For example, if you will do the test for identification of Mycobacterium tuberculi for tuberculosis, so it is called xenodiagnosis. We are doing diagnosis of tuberculosis by identifying the microorganism Mycobacterium tuberculosis, like that. And entomorphological survey means you are doing the survey of insects, various insects like any flea, fly, or any spider, scorpio, or a cricket, or cockroach, or mosquito. So what you are discussing here, mosquito. So when we are doing the survey of mosquito, how many numbers of mosquitoes are there, how they are biting, in how many numbers they are available, what is their time of biting, which type of bacteria, viruses, or fungi, or protozoa, or parasites they are containing. So that sort of studies, In that, we are dissecting the mosquitoes. We are dissecting their body, they are identifying their stomach, their head, their prostatus, and their thoracic cavity. We are identifying each and every part. And we are checking that which parasite or which microorganism they are containing. So in this fashion, we are identifying. DEC provocation test. Microfilary can be induced to appear in blood in the daytime by administering DEC 100 mg orally. Microfilary begins to reach their peak within 15 minutes and begin to decrease 2 hours later. Clinical survey. People are examined for clinical manifestations of filariasis. Serological test. We are taking serum here to identify the various antibodies, to get the antibodies to the microfilary, and adult using immunofluorescent and complement fixing techniques, but cannot distinguish between past and present infections and heavy and light parasitic load. Xenodiagnosis. Mosquitoes are allowed to feed on the patient and then dissected 2 weeks later. Entomological survey. It consists of general mosquito collection. We are collecting all the types of mosquitoes from the houses, and dissection of female vector species for dissection of developmental forms of the parasites to check their developmental forms. How many days they require to develop the larva, to develop their adult form, how they are spreading, how they are again biting to the human being again. Study of the extent of type of breeding places. So check the nearby areas, localities where the drainage system has been collapsed, or what are the various sources to do the breeding sites to accumulation of water. So all these things has to be surveyed. Assessment of filarial control programs. It can be assessed using clinical parameters, parasitological parameters, and entomological parameters. Clinical parameters: incidence of acute manifestations and prevalence of chronic manifestations are measured. Parasitological parameters: microfilia rate. It is the percentage of people showing microfilary in their peripheral blood in the same population. Now, filarial endemicity rate. It is a percentage of people examined showing microfilary in their blood and disease manifestations of or both. Microfilarial density. It is a number of microfilary per unit volume of blood in samples from individual people. It indicates the intensity of infection. Average infestation rate. It is the average number of microfilary per positive slide. It indicates the prevalence of microfilaria in the population. Entomological parameters. They comprise vector density per 10 man hour catch. Percentage of mosquitoes positive for all stages of development. Percentage of mosquitoes positive for infective larva. Annual biting rate means in 1 year, what is the percentage or proportion of biting. Types of larval breeding places. Now, control measures. The current strategy is based on chemotherapy and vector control. Now, chemotherapy. In that, first is DEC, diethyl carbamazepine. Second is filarial control in the mass and selective treatment, and DEC medicated. And third is ivermectin. Now, first DEC, it is a safe and effective drug. In case of filariasis of Bancroftian filariasis, dose is 6 mg per kg body weight per day orally for 12 days. For Bruin filariasis, it is 3 to 6 mg per kg of body weight per day orally for 12 days. It is given in divided doses after a meal, rapidly absorbed, reaches peak blood level in 1 to 2 hours, and rapidly excreted. Now, filarial control in the community. There are filaria control in the community in mass therapy, in the selective treatment and the DEC mitigate salt. Now the mass therapy. DEC is given in everyone, means blindly you will give that drug to the every person in the community, irrespective of whether they have microfilaria or not, means irrespective of they are having infection or not. So disease manifestations or no sign of infections except children under 2 years, means only you are giving exceptions to the children below 2 years and pregnant woman and seriously ill patient, and remaining all patients you will give with this therapy of drug. Dose is 6 mg per kg of body and indicated in highly endemic areas, means when we are more prone to that disease, means you are supposed to have that disease if your locality, if your family, if they, these people are having that disease, so there may be chances of having that infection. So prophylactically you are giving that drug, means before infection you are taking this drug for preventing the infection, for avoiding the infections. You are giving this drug to all your local or your localities or your family members, the people who are residing in that area. And selective treatment, the person who has been identified as a positive microfilaria patients, only those patients are receiving this treatment. So DEC is given only to those who are microfilaria positive or more suitable in low endemicity areas, means where there are very rare chances of this infection. In that cases you should give this treatment selectively, and dose would be the same 6 mg DEC diethyl carbamazepine per kg of body weight daily for 12 doses. In the endemic areas it should be repeated every 2 years. Vector control is beneficial when used in the conjunction with mass treatment. The most important step is to reduce the target mosquito population to stop or reduce the transmission. It consists of anti-larval measures, anti-adult measures and personal prophylaxis. Means when you are killing this larva, so it is anti-larval measures. So anti-adult, when you are killing the adult parasites, it is anti-adult measures. And personal prophylaxis, when you are taking the drugs for avoiding the infections, for avoiding their transmission to you. So prophylactically if you are taking these drugs, not having that infections, for avoiding that infections, it is called personal prophylaxis. Now National Filaria Control Program, it is operational since 1955. In June 1978, it was emerged with malaria scheme. Along with the malaria, this filaria scheme again has been launched. And filaria control strategy includes vector control through anti-larval operations. Means you have to kill the larva or don't allow larva to flourish. Source reduction means where the breeding has been occur or larva will grow, so try to block their breeding, source reduction. And detection and treatment of microfilaria carriers, so you should avoid their carriers. Carrier means if it is human being, you should isolate those human beings, don't allow them to rebite or biting by the mosquitoes, to avoid their reinfections or to avoid the spreading of that infection from that person to the another person, another non-infective person. Morbidity management, so you should manage the person who is suffering from that disease, give them drugs symptomatically for constant period, so that, and also you should constantly routinely monitor the patient whether they are getting effect of that drug or not and how they are cured. Thank you. I think you have come across with this point. I have discussed with each and every shade of that topic. I hope you understood. Thank you for hearing me. Bye.